Derek had to go, so we believe that you all would tell him how good it was tonight anyway. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I am so glad you're here tonight. Are you glad to be here?
Yes, amen.
Well, these have been some awesome meetings, haven't they?
Yes.
We've even been talking about maybe even working together a little more closely, Pastor Hill and I. And I think it's a long time coming, but I believe with all of my heart that there's going to be some great things that come about. And, you know, there's just some things that sometimes, I'll just be honest with you, sometimes, unless you go the extra mile and worship God just past when we're supposed to do the announcements, when we're supposed to do the baby dedications, and what we're supposed to do with all of our regular schedules, whatever we have planned, if we just sometimes press past that just a little bit, it's almost like God rewards us for not having everything set up the way man wants to do it. And there was something special about tonight's worship and pressing in. As great as those song choices, and I thank God for your worship leader. He just picks great songs to worship God with. But I tell you, there was something about when he said the new song, I was like, that man understands the prophetic. We know the Word of God comes out of him, and you got good people in place because your pastors have the Word of God that is just enveloping and overflowing out of them, and we honor them, don't we? God be all the glory. Thank God for those shepherds. And, you know, but when the worship leader said new song, I was like, you know, that's something I hadn't heard in a while. It's not that I don't believe in it, it's just it seems like the church doesn't. And so when he started doing that, I'm like, I'm not taking this lightly. God's doing something prophetically in this house. And as we began to worship God, we began to see some things. I don't know about you, but did you see anything start to transfigure in you? There was just something about worshiping him just a little bit longer without any rhyme or reason, just flowing in the Holy Ghost that took us all to another level. Amen? So I just thank God that you did that. You know, we've got some great product back there. I want you to make yourself available to that. We're also calling in 100 partners before the end of the year. If you have that in your heart, it doesn't matter if it's $1, doesn't matter if it's $100, doesn't matter if it's $1,000, and we certainly won't get upset if it's $1,000,000. But if you want to partner with our ministry, you shouldn't have said, ha ha, you should have said, next. Come on now, I believe one day our ministry, we're going to be able to give another ministry $1,000,000. Wouldn't bother you, would it, if it was right here at Northside Christian Center, would it? Might become Southside Christian Center overnight. Look at your neighbor and say, I ain't moving. All right, praise the Lord. It's so good to have some friends with us. We have Artist Diss again back with us tonight, Holy Ghost woman of God. And then, of course, she picked up a hitchhiker that we just met now. A dear, dear, sweet lady of the Lord is Lydia Brown. We're so glad to have them with us here. So thank God for that. Well, praise the Lord. I believe with all of my heart that God has a message for us tonight. I believe he had one last night, too. If you weren't here last night, please, if you can. I don't know if they're making the CDs or tapes available, but please get those. We've been having a good time in the Spirit, good time in the Word. How many of y'all are feeling refreshed and rejuvenated, right? Those that aren't here tonight. They're home resting. But praise the Lord. I was listening to somebody here recently that I just agree with wholeheartedly, and he said these words. He says he believes the days of casual church is coming quickly to an end. I remember, although I wasn't completely, extremely disciplined, didn't extremely grow up in a strong, disciplined church setting. I think some of you can tell that, but praise God, I got saved out of some stuff too, amen? But you know, although that is the case, when we did go, it was disciplined. And that doesn't mean you can't have fun in church, but I think you should still give God your best, even if the best of your neighbor isn't good enough, it still is to God. And I think showing up on time is relevant. I think that says a lot. I think, getting up and leaving during an altar call, I think those days should come to an end. I think if Ananias and Sapphira were here to testify today that they went to a dead church. You'll get that later. I mean, drop dead for lying about stuff in church. Just drop dead. And I'm not here to get into all of that. I believe God's a loving God, a forgiving God, a God that's full of mercy and grace. But I believe also that we should honor Him as much as we do the president.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Somebody say something.
Yeah.
I said, I think we should honor him as much as we do Justin Bieber. More. You know, I think we should honor him as much as we do some of these other people that are supposedly famous, you know. But a lot of times what we do is we come in and we want the preacher to preach on what we want him to preach on. But we saw that. That's another message. We'll go on. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And I'm going to preach a message that you want me to preach. Just kidding. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And Paul writing to the church at Corinth here. Now, you know, religiously, I guess we could, you know, open up in prayer. But I believe we just had this flow of prayer and worship this whole time. I think we just need to jump right in. Amen. I believe God's going to direct us. I believe God's going to direct me to speak. And you're going to have ears to hear. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6, Paul writing here says, I, Paul, have planted. Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. Somebody shout increase.
Increase.
Come on, somebody shout increase.
Increase.
Somebody shout increase.
Increase.
Somebody declare increase.
Increase.
The thing is, if you can't shout it in church, you won't do it at home.
That's right. Yeah.
Increase.
If you don't shout it here, you can't shout it at Walmart. If you can't decree a thing and open up your mouth, because a lot of times, guys, we got to understand, as men, we want to be quiet. We want to be mature. We want to be reserved. We want to be men, you know, and hold it in and everything like that. It'd be silly for me to decree this and decree that, especially if I'm not seeing it. But one thing I would encourage you to do is to start declaring increase over your finances. I believe one of the things that I saw that broke part of that cloud was your increase is on its way now. If you want to partake in the recession, I can't stop you. But as an anointed man of God, I can certainly encourage you not to. And I can give you direction on how not to. The recession is affecting a lot of people right now. But just like I've said before, 9/11, horrible, tragic, just ridiculous. When we were terrorized and the Twin Towers came down and the attack upon our freedom, not just America, but our freedom. And if anyone in here has lost anyone in 9/11, you have my heart and condolences. But I want you to know that just as many people that died, there are just as many testimonies of those that heard in their heart, don't go to work today. Get out of the building now. Something's not right. I'm hearing the Lord tell me. Something kept me from going, well, what about those, brother, that died? I'm not here to judge that, but I will say this. They probably, at one point, if they didn't hear a voice, they at least ignored something that was nudging them.
Yes, yes, yes.
I'll tell you a story real quick about this. A worship leader, a friend of, a mutual friend of ours, we were doing a camp meeting together, Kate McVeigh. And we were talking about this, and she said these words as she brought up a worship leader that had passed away in an airplane accident. And I said, I've always wanted to know about that story. She goes, I knew him personally, and that was her home church. And the home church situation was that they were all coming back, the worship team and some others were coming back on their way in a snowstorm. And one of the things that was reported, because she, Kate, knows the widow very well, she was talking to her, and she said that her husband got on the phone and said, there's something telling me not to get on this plane. But it's our anniversary. It was their first anniversary. And I want to be there to spend it with you. As you know the story, he ended up going down in an accident. There were two other pastors that were supposed to be on that plane, which she also knew. And she herself was supposed to be on that plane too. And all of those three instances, and especially the one that died, all had heard in their heart, don't get on this plane. Something wasn't right. But I want you to know this, that although those three got off, this one man did not. Because he felt in his heart that he wanted to be with his wife on their first anniversary. You can't blame him. But the thing is he never got to spend that anniversary. I would so wish to have missed my first anniversary if I knew I could have 30 more after that.
Yes, yes, yes.
So it's important to hear from the Holy Spirit. And Paul, writing here, said that I've planted, Apollos watered, but God's the one who gave the increase. I'm here to tell you tonight that God's still giving the increase. I said He's still giving the increase, even in the midst of a recession. The increase that's happening and flowing right now is being drowned out and masked by the enemy, who's trying to get everyone to look and see that he is creating a recession. Come on. He is the one that's creating this falsehood, because it's the antidote to God's blessing on your life. Come on, somebody say amen anyway. As a man thinks, Proverbs says, in his heart, so is he. What do you think about this situation? Well, brother, nobody will hire me. Ah? There's no jobs available for me. Ah? All right. Are you kidding me? At my age, nobody wants to hire me. Stop! Do you hear what I'm doing? I'm stopping you from thinking and saying the wrong thing. Do you know I wouldn't even be where I'm at today? And I'm not just talking about Northside Christensen. Am I a little hot? I sound a little hot on this thing. I just want you to know that no matter what others have said to me and said about me, have not stopped me from standing where they said I couldn't stand. What other people say about you ain't none of your business. What other people think about you ain't none of your business. We can fight it. We can argue it. And when it's all said and done, whatever you say, you're right. If you say you can't do it, I'm sorry. I don't agree with you, but you're right. But what I say about me will always trump what somebody else says about me. Because if I'm lining up what I say about me is the same thing that God's saying about me, then I'm ensuring that my victories will always come to pass. If the doctor says I'm sick and dying, but I keep saying I'm alive and well, I will live and not die. I will testify of the Lord all the days of my life. I've got plenty of days ahead of me. By whose stripes I am healed right now. Not going to be. I am. Don't feel like it, but I am. Don't look like it, but I am. So guess what? What you say about me doesn't matter. And like I said the other night, I mean, when somebody comes up to you, the day you're feeling the best of all the days you've been feeling like junk, that's the day they go, what's wrong with you? You don't look good. And you're like, this is the day I was feeling the best. Come on. What other people say about you ain't none of your business. You want to increase? Stop listening to decrease. I said, you want to increase? Stop listening to decrease. If you don't want that, then you don't have to have that. Brother, I have my pension, my retirement, government check. Do I have to keep going on? My dependence on a system has got to never be greater than my dependence on the kingdom.
That's right.
So 1 Corinthians 3 and verse 6 says, God is the one who gives the increase. Yes. And I like that in verse 7. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither is he that watereth, but God that gives the increase. Now he that plants and he that waters are one. Every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. For you are laborers together with God. You are God's husbandry. You are God's building. Now, you still have to do something. Brother, I'm trying. But what we see here is we're in a covenant. And this covenant, if you'll go with me over to Genesis. Getting so much. You guys are hungry tonight, aren't you?
Yeah.
How many of y'all believe you're going to leave here with the anointing of increase upon you?
Yeah.
Genesis chapter 17. And it was in Northside Christian Center that my Bible fell apart. But I ain't bitter. I'm better. So those of you where your Bible pages are sticking together, look what you get to look forward to. All right, now, Genesis 17, we are in a covenant of increase. Shout increase.
Increase.
Somebody shout, I'm increasing.
I'm increasing.
Even while you're sitting here, you are.
Amen.
In verse 1, and when Abram was 90 years old and 9, the Lord appeared to Abram and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect. And I will make my covenant between me and you, and I will multiply. What is that word?
Exceedingly.
Right? Multiplication is huge in and of itself. But he said, I'm going to multiply you exceedingly. That's increase. That means it doesn't matter what's going on around you. All that matters is you understand what's going on in you. You've got a covenant of increase with the Almighty God. Walk before Him and He'll multiply you exceedingly. Brother, I've heard this before. Yeah, but you may not have heard how to get there. I'm going to show you how to get there. I'm going to show you how to apply this. I'm going to show you how to walk in this. I want people walking up to you and going, how are you doing this? You selling dope. And he goes on to say, Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be a father of many nations. Neither shall your name anymore be called Abram, but the name shall be Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made you. And I will make you exceeding fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come out of you. Oh, somebody ought to get excited. Listen now. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your seed after you in their, I'm getting ready to call your name, in their generations. I may not be the seed of Abraham, but I'm in there with the generations. That means everything he just gave to Abraham, he is now given to you and I, because we, as we'll see in a minute, are blessed with faithful Abraham. The covenant that God made with Abraham is not the old covenant, it was the fresh covenant with him. That covenant is a covenant of blessing. You and I are blessed beyond measure, although it may not look like it, it may not sound like it, it may not feel like it. We are blessed right now with faithful Abraham. So start thinking the right way and start thinking the right way, and your thinking and your thanking will take you to where you're supposed to be. I heard this one time. What if we woke up today with everything that we thanked God for yesterday? I'm going to tell you how the majority of people think. I said, what if you woke up today with everything that you thanked God for yesterday? If you woke up today with everything that you thanked God for yesterday, what would it have been?
My life.
Yeah. Most people, their food.
Look at a story.
Well, no, listen, I'm being honest.
Yeah, being honest. My life.
If we only wake up every day with what we thank God for, we have to ask ourselves, what have we been thanking Him for? Now, the majority of people think that way. Well, I didn't hardly thank Him. That's why I hardly have anything. But, look at the horizon. If that is a good theory, then guess what? If I begin to thank Him right now, between now and midnight, my goodness, what by faith can I see operating and manifesting in my life as I begin to thank Him? Oh, I hope you're getting a hold of this, because I came to preach to a funeral home tonight. I came to raise the dead tonight. Hallelujah. Look at your neighbor and say, that's got to be you, even if you're snoring. You can, all right, come on. Like I said last night, we need to stop keeping our eyes open during praise and worship and keeping our eyes shut during the message. We need to do it the other way around. But here we see that God is making a covenant with Abraham, except at this point he's called Abram, and he said, I'm going to multiply you exceedingly. Out of you are going to come nations. Out of you, you're going to be the father of those nations. Out of you, kings are going to come out of you. Come on now. You've got a royal priesthood. and are a royal priesthood. You are considered kings in God's eyes. And what is he? He's the king of all kings. So now, he says to Abram, I'm going to change your name to Abraham. Because I made you Abraham and not Abram. I've got this covenant I'm placing with you, putting it between you and I, but I've got to change what we've been calling things so that what I'm calling will come to pass. Yes. Amen. I hope you enjoyed my bedtime story tonight. I'm telling you, if you'll start calling things differently than what you've been calling them, the covenant of blessing and increase that God has given to you and I, we can change the name of what we've been calling certain things in our lives and start to see this covenant of blessing begin to manifest in our hearts.
Amen. Praise God.
In our hearts, in our bodies, in our minds, in our kids, in our finances. I'll never forget when I was in seventh grade. That was about the year I found out there was no recess. I don't know what I was expecting, but I knew that every other class that I had lunch, after I had lunch, they gave me a break out in the prison yard before we went back in and had school. You know what I'm talking about. You lived for lunch and recess. But the thing is if you'll notice, in the midst of the word recession is the word recess. It's a time that is a break. A recession. An aggressive session of recessing. God never wants us to digress or recess or go back. He's wanting us to always go forward from glory to glory, faith to faith. He never wants us to look back. He wants us to look forward. Now, I've got something I want you to do prophetically. I want everybody to turn around and look behind them. If you turn to Saul, it ain't my fault. Hold on now. Everybody take a look back there.
All right.
Now look this way. That's the last time you're ever going to look back.
Amen.
I'm glad that tickled that funny bone, but that wasn't the one I was talking to. Because too many people are always looking back. Always saying these words, if I could just get back to the way things were. If I could just get back to this. Where did we hear that before? Pharaoh, if we could have just gotten back there. And never left. If we could just get back to your old brickyards and keep cooking bricks. Moses, if we'd never followed your silly self and kept going and staying back here in the brickyards with Pharaoh and never left there, stayed there getting sunburned, getting dehydrated, getting overheated, staying there getting whipped and beaten and ridiculed. It would have been far better for us never to have. Why are you looking back to that? Is your freedom really that bad now? Come on, you're facing a Red Sea. Is it really that bad? No, because you're thinking that it'd been better to be alive and being tortured than to be in freedom about to face death. Amen. Joan of Arc, young 14, 15-year-old girl, a warrior, captured and asked as a crusader, why are you doing this? Don't you know you're about to lose your life? And she goes, I'm not losing anything. She said, it'd be far worse to have lived my entire life fighting for a cause I don't believe in than to die at an early age for something I totally believe in.
Amen. That's right.
What are we fighting for? What is our fight? What are we living for? Oh, I'm telling you, it's getting deep here right now. Some of you don't like this because we're pruning a little bit, but that's all right. You can dodge, shove, jive. It's all right. We'll be all right. But the thing is, here, he said to him, I'm changing your name. Why? I'm changing what we have always known you to be called. Some of us have got to look at our finances and stop saying it's hurting because of the finances. You got to change the name and start saying I'm prosperous. Well, brother, you don't understand how many checks I've bounced. I'm keeping the rubber companies in business. I got bills that are so big, they're called Williams. I got bills that grow mouths and talk to me, and I will pile them under stuff so I don't have to face them. But they'll always go, psst, I'm over here. See? You know what I'm talking about. I've been there. I know. I know what it's like. And I tell you, it didn't happen until I knew what the covenant of increase was. It's irrelevant to the recession. It's irrelevant to a depression. And then the Lord showed me an interesting fact. Anybody want to hear it tonight? Okay, well, I'll talk to you, sister, right after this. Anybody else want to hear it? More millionaires are made during these times than any other time. More millionaires are made during this time than any other time. That's why you've been having that stirring on the inside of you. More millionaires are made during this time than any other time. Well, what if somebody would have told them we're in a recession? Can I just make somebody in here mad? It's the happy row. Have you noticed that the happy row is like, yeah, you can make us mad. But this sister right here, she's like, I'd rather you not. I didn't realize I'm too close to the front. Everything's safe. We're on camera. Bad boys, what you gonna do? Now, I felt the recession. That was during the time when it first hit several years ago. That I first felt the effects of that. And I told you about getting out of foreclosure. Praise God. But once you feel that, there's always that little thing in the back until you deal with the seed of fear. We'll always be thinking that it's more near than far. Now listen to this. I had to change the way I was thinking. I had to change my name, so to speak. I had to change what I was calling things. And so the Lord showed me this. He said to me, he goes, I want you to start laying hands on your house every time you go out to take the trash. So I did. I take the trash out, put it there on the curb, turn around, and lay hands on my house. There's nothing wrong with my house, but the Lord told me, he says, start changing the name of it. Call it paid off. Yeah. Instead of 19804 something, 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 he said, call it paid off. Are you kidding me? What if somebody drove by? We have people driving by. And I'm laying hands on this. I call you paid for and paid off in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I had a little neighbor across the street, a little Jewish man, sitting in his front row, front window there. That's where his office was. And you see that silhouette of him right there with that blue light where he was at his computer, right? Kind of looked like a modern day psycho. You know, you look up in the window and you see that, hey, Norman! You know, and he's right there, he's looking out at it. And I could see that little thing crack open every time I'm out there. It never failed, almost every single time. I'd lay hands on my house and call it paid off and paid for. I'd look and I'd see, you know, because I'm a little paranoid. I'm feeling, you know, I'm stepping out of my comfort zone. I'm not whispering it. I'm not thinking it. I'm calling it paid for. And I look over behind me and I'm seeing that thing go, poof. I knew my little Jewish friend was out there looking at me like, what's he doing to his house every Monday or every Sunday night and every Wednesday night? What's he doing? I go out there for about an entire year. Then I get this call from this man, this businessman. He says to me, he goes, can we go to lunch? I said, sure. We go to lunch, we're eating, and we're having a good time. And then he says to me, he says, I want to tell you something. When I first met you, I did not like you. And I'm thinking, what is this lunch going to turn into? He goes, you weren't anything I'd ever seen traditionally. You weren't anything I grew up with religiously. You broke the mold. You don't look like a minister. You don't talk like a minister. But what I could not understand is how you got more results than any of the others that we called ministers. Praise God. And he says, you have ministered to my family more than you could ever know. You and your wife are such a blessing. He said, I'm going to ask you a question. God's been blessing us here. And he says, I want to know, what would it take to sell your house? And I said, I mean, this is intelligent college talk. I said, somebody buying it? I didn't know. I didn't know where he was going. I didn't know what he wanted to know. I was like, yes, somebody to buy it. And he said this. He goes, how fast do you think you can sell it? And I said, can I just ask you, why are you wanting to buy it? That doesn't make sense. And he goes, no, the Lord wants us to give you a brand new house.
Huh? Doesn't that make you excited? Because now you're like, oh good, I don't have to sow in the offering. He's blessed. You're missing it. You want to look for good ground like this.
That's right.
You don't want to be sowing into broke, busted, disgusted preachers, do you?
No.
Playing blues songs like, no. I ain't got no money, but I want to sell money. We're going to pass the bucket. Don't you try to duck yet. Get out your wallet. Don't you try to swallow it. Come on. You don't want somebody to sing the blues to you. You want somebody that's going somewhere. You want to sow to somebody that's been there, done that, conquered that, moving on. So he says, I want to give you a new house. 3,000 square foot home. Hardwood floors, real ones, not the peel-up ones that I've had before. The kind you could get splinters, but it's too smooth to get splinters. I'm talking about the stuff that's not the peel-on countertops. I'm talking about the kind that are real.
Wood.
The kind that my wife would like. She lives in that kitchen. She likes that. You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, you got these amount of bed. And I'm thinking, I was not praying, God give me a new house. I was obeying what he said in the law of increase, where he said, call your house a different name. I'm only trying to make you mad, to make you go, huh, if God will do it for him, then why won't he do it for me? That's the man I want. That's the man I want to see. It ain't a white thing. He's got too many black friends that God's blessing more than me, and I'm going to have a talk with him about that, all right? So you just get off of that.
All right.
It ain't that. God is no respecter of color. Thank God. He's no respecter of race. Praise God. You know how I know? Because every race, every color, every creed is in God. Is God a black man? Yes. Is God a white man? Yes. Why? Because all of us are created from Him.
Amen.
Oh, glory to God. So turn with me to Romans chapter 4 real quick. And then you can get your place in Galatians. But God has given us the law of increase and a covenant. Man, a covenant is so powerful. Well, brother, now that we're in the New Testament, hasn't that been done away with? Not this one. Not the covenant. Not that one with Abraham. He changed the name so that he would fit in to what he was calling it to be. Glory to God. Which means what? You weren't the father of many nations, but I'm changing your name because I created you to be. So I remember the Lord said to me, he says, because you kept calling your house paid for, you opened up the anointing for increase. And he said, I was able to begin to speak to people. This may shock you, but there were others that were supposed to bless us before him. Praise the Lord. In the midst of a recession, I can tell you one thing after another where God's blessed us. Because I refuse for that stupid devil to have free reign in your life, in my life, in the church's life. Glory. Shout increase.
Increase.
Thank you. Romans chapter 4, verse 17. I'm going to read out of the Amplified so that it's a little loud. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. He was appointed our father in the sight of God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and speaks of the non-existent things that he has foretold and promised as if they already exist. You may not feel healed, you may not look healed, the doctor's report may confirm you are not healed. But if I say you're healed and you believe you're healed, I'm calling forth that which be not as though it already exists. And I can call forth those things that don't seem to exist as if they do exist if it's something God has promised me. If he's given me healing, 2,000 years ago is when I received my healing. You know, God brought this to me now about the third time. Somebody's been dealing with arthritic pain, especially in your wrists. Who is that? Come on, quickly. And I'm going to have you just move your wrists around and just see that pain go. It's almost like a carpal tunnel, but it's an arthritic condition. Come on, now I know I'm not missing it. I know because God has told me. Glory to God. And it is, it's a woman. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Begin to move your wrists around and just see that pain go. It is you, isn't it? That pain's all going because I call it gone. I call it healed. The pain's already beginning to go. You can feel like almost a, I don't want to call it a burning sensation, but like a warmth. It's just going. Glory to God. You're healed, sister. Glory to God. 2,000 years ago, right then. What we're going to do at the end of this service may shock you because it almost seems too simplistic to work. But that's how my God works. So don't forget to remind me about that. God uses wives as the Holy Spirit sometimes. All right, now, he calls those things that be not as though they were. So what do? We've got to stop calling things that are as though they'll always be.
Right.
You've got to stop calling that piece of junk car a piece of junk car. You gotta stop saying that my broke down mother. You gotta stop saying my broke down body. You've gotta stop saying things and being a reporter for the demonic inquirer. God is not asking you to report a bunch of junk the devil's doing, because truthfully, you're not going to agree with it completely, but it's still true. That is almost borderline demonic worship, because you're glorifying the things the devil's doing by broadcasting. Can't get somebody to shout increase, can't get somebody to shout I'm saved, can't get somebody to shout I'm healed unless I feel healed, but I can sure get them to say what the doctor says, sure get them to say what the mechanic said. Are you hearing me? I'm telling you, we've got to start calling those things that be not as though they were, and start saying, this is how it is. God gave it to me. This is the way it is. God gave it to me. I refuse anything less. God said I could have it. I'm not going to see it, anything else manifest in my life except for this thing that God said I could have. The reason some things exist in our life are beyond demonic has to do with our mouth.
Yes.
Do you remember what the Lord said about in Genesis 1, let's make man in our
image.
Come on, let's make man in our
image.
That means the way man looks is how God looks. And when he said, let's make man in our image, that means not just merely how he looks, but if you study that out, it's how he is. That means let's make man as a creative being. That's why when he said to Abraham, what are you going to name the fowl? He said, I'm going to name him this. He goes, you know what? You're a creator, I'm a creator, I created you, giving you creative ability. As a matter of fact, that's what I would have called him. Let's call him that. Well, what about the fish? Well, we're going to call him this. Hey, I'm a creator, I created you, gave you creative power, and with your tongue and with your mouth, you called that fish that name. That's what I would have called it. That's good. We'll call it that. Are you following me? And if you ever notice, all through Genesis chapter 1, God was saying, and then he was seeing. God was calling, and then he was seeing. It wasn't God whispered, God believed, God thought. It was simply whatever he said, whatever he vocalized, whatever he decreed, whatever he declared, whatever he called came to pass.
Hallelujah.
And he saw. So when did Adam and Eve lose their creative power? When they gave it over to a counterfeiter. What's the opposite of creativity? Counterfeiting. You're a copycat if you can't create it. And the devil is a copier. He cannot create. That's why he needs you to be his mouthpiece. And what that means is this. If I cannot create it, but I can use you to create it. I cannot put sickness on you because that would make me a creator. I cannot do that. But if I can get you to start thinking it, if I can start getting you to speak it, then I can get you to create what I cannot create. If I cannot put poverty on you, but it is a spirit. But if I can get you to think the wrong things, if I can get you to say the wrong things, I'm broke. I'm never going to amount to anything. I'll never get out of this. I'm going to have to go bankrupt again. I'm on my fourth bankruptcy. I'm on my fifth divorce. I guess this is just my lot in life. No. That is not your lot in life. If you don't like where you are, hear me. If you don't like the way things have been, I'm telling you from experience, change what you are saying. We're a product of what we've been saying. We are the sum total of what we've been speaking. If we don't like it, then we've got to change it. I am so glad that my wife said, I will marry an ugly man. She got what she said.
Amen.
Some of y'all are not laughing. Some of you are. Some are like, yes, she did. Yeah. A very, very, very unattractive individual. But you know what? This is a true story, and I don't want to put her on blast, but it's still the truth. My mother came over to our house, and she had just recently, at this time, years ago, been diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. And so you know as well as I do about that disease that, you know, your lifestyle changes, your food changes, everything changes. It's a hassle, okay? Not that any disease is a pleasure trip, but this is a hassle. Well, we weren't thinking that. I've always known mom as mom, invited her over for her birthday, had this big cake made, oh, barbecue. It was nice. It was just, it was, you know, I would have been her favorite son again. Except she says, son, I can't eat any of this. Like, yes, you can. You're not that fat. Of course, now I've offended her. But she said, it wasn't because I was fat, it's because I've got diabetes and I can't eat that. Well, of course, no matter how old you get, you still get spanked. And so, it's a rough crowd tonight, I'm glad. Talking to a bunch of spanking mothers in here. But she said to me, she goes, I can't eat that. I said, well, what the barbecue you can, because that's meat. She goes, no, the sauce is full of sugar. I'm like, wow. Here I am, I invite her over with stuff that's loaded with sugar. No longer favorite son. And it just rose up on the inside of me. I said, Mom, your trip here is not wasted. As long as you're in my house. Should I say it? As long as you're in my house, you're healed. That disease cannot operate in your body.
Amen.